I want to welcome everyone in and thank you for tuning in to a Valentine's Day edition of Tailgaters, where we will sensually take you around the world in the name of sport. I'm Cameron Redler, hoping this show is very lovely, Troy.
I'm Troy D'Souza, and Cam, as long as we're the hosts, it's going to be. Coming up on the show, pitchers and catchers reporting signifies the end of the offseason in baseball, so Isaac Jahns will be here to recap the offseason.
And Max Arnold is here to play Cupid for the NBA. Tailgaters starts right now.
The West Virginia Mountaineers in Morgantown.
Troy, only three head coaches of Mizzou have won their debuts.
This is Tailgaters.
We'd like to welcome our social media guru, Isaac Jahns, here. Isaac, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me, guys.
So guys, winter's almost over, you know, as we've seen in some of the weather as well. It means the transition is into spring. That means baseball is upon us at last.
That is correct, Troy. Today was the last day for pitchers and catchers to report, officially bringing the MLB offseason to a close.
And you know, the MLB offseason typically fly under the radar. You know, football's ending, basketball's kind of overlapping with that. Does not mean that major moves didn't happen. So Isaac, we'll start with this first. What was the biggest or most impactful move of the offseason?
I think without a doubt it's got to be Chris Sale to the Boston Red Sox. He changes his socks from white to red, and I think it means big things for both clubs. So the Red Sox rotation just went from having, I mean, two great guys in David Price and Rick Porcello. Now this is, you could say the Boston Red Sox rotation right now is all-time great with three high-end starters. So, like I said, you have Chris Sale, David Price, and then the reigning Cy Young winner. So that's a triple threat that we haven't seen in a long time, I think. And there's been a lot of good rotation in the past few years. And, I mean, the White Sox, they don't get anything to win now, but they get Yoan Moncada, the number one prospect from Boston. So their rebuild is looking really good, but they're going to be really bad for the next few years.
Yeah, I like the pick. I'm actually going to go on the offensive side of the ball. I like Edwin Encarnacion going to the Indians from the Blue Jays, third in the American League in home runs last year, led the league in RBIs. He's got three All-Stars in the last 4 years. He's going to add some thump to that lineup at that first base position, DH position, wherever they play him, that the Indians didn't necessarily have last year. And remember how close they were to winning the World Series. Maybe a guy like Encarnacion is the difference maker.
Definitely could be.
Absolutely. And Isaac, I like your pick a lot. One other name I'd like to toss out, Dexter Fowler. Obviously, we know the story with that from, you know, winning the World Series with the Cubs, transition to the Cardinals, but I think he's a very valuable producer at the top of the lineup and definitely kind of fills, you know, a very pressing need at center field. So I think he's going to kind of have a pretty immediate impact. Obviously, they paid a hefty price for him, but I think it'll pay off.
With Dexter Fowler on the Cardinals now, their top three hitters in the lineup, their average on base percentage is at 380, which means more times than not, you're going to get a base runner on every time those three come up in the rotation. Isaac, which team improved the most, do you think?
I also think this one's kind of pretty obvious. There was one team that made a lot of moves over the winter, and it was the Atlanta Braves. They went from having one good starter in Julio Teheran, and they added Jaime Garcia, the man, the myth, the legend, Big Sexy himself, Bartolo Colon.
The GOAT.
And also the knuckleballer. I think he's just about as old as Bartolo, R.A. Dickey. So they have three quality starters in that rotation that they've just added this year. In addition to Teheran. Now, in the past few days, they've also signed second baseman Brandon Phillips. They just got that in a trade from the Reds. So I do like that infield with Brandon Phillips and Dansby Swanson. That is, they're going to be some really good double plays in Atlanta over the summer with that.
That whole middle of the field now between Inciarte in center, Phillips at second, and Dansby at short, you don't want to hit the ball up the middle against that team.
No,
they're gonna run down a lot of hits.
Yeah.
As for the rotation, though, I think it's a little bit shaky still.
I'm not sure
Bartolo. I mean, we say this every year, it feels like. But I don't. This might be the year. I have a feeling that he comes back down to earth a little bit. And
right.
Jaime, for as good as he can be when he's on the field, he's very rarely on the field. This is his first full season in 4 years, a season ago. And he struggled down the stretch. He was gassed.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot remains to be seen there. I'm going to give you another team. I'm going to go with the Rockies. And the Rockies, a couple under the radar signs. They added Ian Desmond and Greg Holland. And Ian Desmond, an all-star a year ago, just adds to this lineup even more thump, if you can believe it.
Yeah.
The Rockies, I think the Rockies have finally come to the conclusion that they are never going to get a big starting pitching signing. No one wants to play in Colorado. So their whole plan is to out-hit people. And this lineup, top to bottom, is so stacked. And now adding Greg Holland to the back of this bullpen, a guy who has three seasons with an ERA under two, back-to-back 45 seasons with the Royals not too long ago, coming off an injury, so a little under the radar, but a guy who I think is going to help the Rockies significantly close out games that the offense is going to give them a lot of opportunities to win.
Yeah, Cam, I like that pick a lot. I'm going to agree with Isaac over here, though. I think Atlanta obviously got a definite improvement, that's for sure. Obviously, you know, still probably middle of the pack. You know, I don't think the improvement's enough to make a wild card or playoff push by any means. But
now, like, I do want to say one more thing. There's teams in the past that have done this before, and they haven't really worked out well. You see, right. 2 years ago, you had the San Diego Padres sign Matt Kemp, and they signed a ton of people. A.J. Preller was making a ton of moves, and they finished, I think, last in their division. Then last year was the Arizona Diamondbacks, Zach Greinke, right. Shelby Miller, right. And they didn't do anything at all. So I could definitely see this Braves team completely just flopping. But on paper, they're definitely the most improved team.
Right. When you had, especially they also added Sean Rodriguez, Micah Johnson, some other guys to throw in there, filling some big utility roles, adding some bench depth.
Sean Rodriguez actually, unfortunately,
unlucky
break for the Braves, a car accident just last month from a drunk driver. Stolen police car. And he's going to miss a couple months, if not the whole season. Mm.
That's why they signed Brandon Phillips. That's why they did that trade. Yeah.
But yeah, regardless, wow, that's unfortunate.
The Braves definitely did take significantly
forward, though. And we just talked about that last show, all these tragic car accidents, in this case a little more on the...
Not his fault this time. This is a very random occurrence.
Yeah, this is something else. But again, and also they still got them the top prospects coming up. We talked about Swanson a little bit. I like the Atlanta Braves. I think there's definitely some improvement. I don't think enough to put them over the edge, but like you said, also has potential to fall flat on their face.
Exactly.
If they push 500, though, that's a successful season.
Especially
from a year ago.
Yeah. Of course, for being the worst team in the league for 6 out of 7 months of the season.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but Isaac, so we talked about lots of improvement, but which team took a step back? Any teams not too eventful in the offseason?
Yeah, I think it was the Chicago White Sox who took away any hope of them being any sort of relevant this year, and it's by design. This is not a team sitting on their laurels and just letting the pack pass them by. They made a decision to say, we are going to be awful for about 3 or 4 years and try and have an extended championship run as the 2020s come into play. They traded Adam Eaton to the Washington Nationals, but they got the Nationals' top pitching prospect, Lucas Giolito, in that trade. Then they also traded Chris Sale to the Red Sox, as we said. They got Yoan Moncada, who was the number one prospect at the time, like in all of baseball. Also got Michael Kopech in that trade, Boston's number one starting pitching prospect. So they have three quality guys in two trades in one season, and that is the beginning, or even, like, that's a core. That is a core of a team that you can have and contend with for years to come. But for right now, yeah, I don't see them winning above 65 games. It's going to be rough and ugly at the worst named field in baseball, Guaranteed Rate Field.
A bad name for a bad team. It also looks like they're probably going to trade Todd Frazier at some point some point this season.
Their closer, David Robertson, in talks with the Nationals to be traded.
We'll see, man. Is there a move, though, that flew under the radar that could have a bigger impact than most expect? We've talked to a couple big names. Give us maybe a guy that a lot of people didn't get too excited for.
Yeah, I'm surprised that this trade did not get – or it's a signing. It's not a trade, it's a free agency signing. Yeah, but I'm surprised it didn't make a bigger splash. It was Koji Uehara to the Cubs for 1 year. And this, I think, makes a bigger deal because Wade Davis is going to be their ninth inning guy, their closer, because now the Cubs can give the ball in the seventh inning to Hector Rondon, who is a good pitcher in his own right and did a serviceable job as the closer for the Cubs before they got Aroldis Chapman. Then you go to Koji Uehara, who was balling for the Boston Red Sox when they won their title in 2013 as their closer. Then you give it to Wade Davis, who was arguably one of the best relievers in baseball and one of the best in the AL last year with the Royals. So you have a very good 7-8-9 rotation in the bullpen to go every night. And if you can get six quality innings from their insane rotation with Arrieta, John Lackey, John Lester, Kyle Hendricks, like those are four guys that can give you six solid innings every night. And then to toss it over to those three guys, I think it's great, and I'm really surprised there aren't a lot of people talking about Uehara or Wade Davis for that matter.
I'll give you one more on the other side of the league. Matt Holliday on the Yankees.
Yes.
A guy, an absolute slugger, and he's finally going to get off the field. He's going to be in a DH role, which I think suits him perfectly. He had had some durability issues playing in the field, but now that he gets to focus just on hitting, and a guy who hit 20 home runs last year in only 382 at-bats, with the short porch and right, with the hitter-friendly park that is Yankee Stadium, I think Matt Holliday is bound for an exceptional year.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I could definitely see as well. That's some veteran leadership for the Yankees that they're going to need with Gary Sanchez, Aaron Judge, Greg Bird, the baby bombers, they called them last year. They're coming up. So I could see Matt Holliday, if he jumps into that veteran role that they've kind of been lacking since Jeter got out of the way.
Grandpa bomber.
Yeah. Yeah. They might make some noise.
I could see it.
Absolutely. And as you mentioned, Wade Davis and the Cubs, as well as part of the, you know, the offseason moves.
Right.
With Aroldis Chapman moving on, obviously re-signing with the Yankees. How do you think he's going to play, Wade Davis is going to fill out that role as a closer compared to Chapman, how Chapman is?
Well, I mean, I think he'll honestly be pretty comparable. Wade Davis does not have the name recognition that Aroldis Chapman does, but he is still a really, really solid reliever. So I think Uehara will do just a great job with the eighth, and Wade Davis will, I mean, he might not be as good as Chapman because he can't throw 105 miles an hour, but his fastball has 98 with tail, and that's really hard to hit. So I see him doing, I mean, being named as an all-star. I think it's an all-star season from Wade Davis and a very solid person to replace Aroldis Chapman.
Him on the Cubs, he's going to get a ton of save opportunities.
Oh, yes.
If you thought he was good with the Royals, imagine the numbers he might put up this year with the Cubs. The possibilities are endless.
I mean, big super under the radar, Mark Melancon to the Giants. The boy wears, like, the glasses, the pitching glasses. Came from the Pirates. I mean, that's a big signing for San Francisco if they want to stay with Los Angeles.
Yeah, you know, the Giants, their recipe for success, especially in postseason time this last 6-7 years or so, has been the bullpen, the strength of their bullpen. Yeah. They lost Javier Lopez, they lost Sergio Romo, but Melancon in the back of that bullpen closing out games, I think fills in just fine.
Very good.
Absolutely. Isaac, thank you for your insight. A lot to look forward to this coming season. When we return, Max Arnold is here to spread some love and squash some NBA beef. Do not touch that dial.
This week on 23 News.
This week on 23 News.
This week on 23 News.
Welcome back to Tailgaters. We are now joined by 23 sports reporter Max Arnold. As it is Valentine's Day, we thought it'd be suitable to bring love to a league that needs it, the NBA. Troy, Max, why can't we all get along?
Who knows?
You know, I thought it'd be easier than that, but apparently not. You know, these grown men need some work.
Some of these grown men, I'm not quite sure, are acting like men right now.
It's true.
Acting like little boys.
It's true. We're going to dive into that. So, Max, there's a couple pairings around the NBA that could use some love. Who's the first pair? Give it to us.
Well, the first pair is going to be Charles Oakley and the Knicks. The former Knicks legend came to a game against the Clippers, and he ended up getting taken out by security guards because he was having a little bit of trouble He got in a fight with the owner, and let's just say this, the Knicks and Charles Oakley are not on good terms. But in the end, they had Commissioner Adam Silver come in and like have an intervention with the two.
With
and
Michael Jordan.
With Michael Jordan,
with Michael Jordan, they brought in the GOAT to help
they
out.
They had to have the GOAT to fix the situation. So I'm hoping that, you know, everything works out and Charles Oakley is welcome back into the stands. That's tough for the Knicks.
What do you think about that, Michael Jordan, of all people, helping squash the beef?
Well, I mean, Michael Jordan, I guess he is the GOAT. I mean,
he's really good friends with Oakley, too. Yeah. That'll have a lot to do with it. But
yeah,
it's just, even so, still a weird pairing, the commissioner and what many people say the greatest of all time player coming into figure the situation out. Very weird situation all around.
Such a mess. The Knicks, not only did they ban Charles Oakley for life at first, they also fired their head of security.
Right.
So which makes me think that maybe they admit some fault.
They're kind of scapegoating the security guard with it too.
Yeah, exactly. And just an absolute mess. Afterwards, they're both trashing each other's character, calling Oakley an alcoholic.
Right.
And
some strong accusations all around.
Yeah, oh my goodness. I, for one, it seems like they did a pretty good job of putting this down and reconciling.
Yeah, they lifted the ban, so there's that. But, you know, obviously what happened was, I don't know, it was quite the outlier in some things we've seen recently.
There's somehow symbolism in this event for the Knicks season.
It's true.
The Knicks, some high expectations coming in, but just drama everywhere. Their best player, Carmelo.
On the trade rumors left and right.
Left and right. Now they're having issues with their Knicks legends. Just a mess of a season.
Yeah, Knicks are definitely not proving to be a very good organization.
No.
Maybe not the place to be as a basketball player. I mean, they want to go to these big cities, but
right.
New York is not looking like a destination for big stars.
But haven't won the title since the 70s.
That's true. But at least the Knicks aren't the worst team in New York.
That is true.
Unfortunately.
Max, tell us now another pair that might need some love.
Another pair. Recently, Kevin Durant came back for his first game at OKC with the Warriors, and this one did not turn out pretty for OKC. The whole time, the fans booed Kevin Durant when he had the ball, and as you'll see here, the players did not take kindly to Kevin Durant here. Russell Westbrook pushing Kevin Durant and later yelling at him. And, you know, this is not good for OKC.
Frankly,
in terms of, it's not professional.
Frankly, absolutely. I thought this was just disrespectful from Oklahoma City. Just not professional in the least, but I think you nailed it right on the head. The fact that they were pushing and shoving and coming after Kevin Durant just so blatantly, instead of just handling it on the court. And what made it worse, being down 20 points, it felt like the entire game, Russell Westbrook yelling that he's coming and Roberson headbutting. It's just a mess. And That being said, I don't necessarily want to take all fault or blame away from Kevin Durant, because a lot of details we don't really know about how much a part of it he's contributed and how much has been Russell Westbrook and the Thunder. But you would think for a guy who basically built the franchise and took him to a finals appearance and countless playoff appearances and got an MVP, you'd think they would treat him with a little bit more respect. This has been really ugly.
Yeah.
That it has. Unfortunately, but yeah, like you were saying, they were playing down 20, 15, 20 most of the whole game. It'd be a different story if it was close throughout the game, but obviously OKC just couldn't keep up, and Russ and Roberson especially had, you know, no problem still taking it to Kevin Durant.
They were talking big games, but not playing big games.
It's not.
Russell Westbrook brought it, but the rest of the team lacking. And
but
I'm looking at Enes Kanter too, who missed this game, but even going back to the games in Golden State, where he was yelling from the bench down 20.
Yeah.
It seems like from the get-go, this team has been out to get Kevin Durant without much success. It might be time to just kill this, move on.
Yeah, they definitely need to move on if they want any success in OKC. I mean, they still got Westbrook. They still have some good pieces with Enes Kanter, Steven Adams, Victor Oladipo, still young. I really think they need to focus on what they have and not what they don't.
Yeah, and Cam, you mentioned, talking about Enes Kanter, I thought that was one of the funnier parts of the video is when, when Russ and KD were kind of getting into it. Enes Kanter comes off the bench, started yelling at KD. Meanwhile, this is the guy who punched a chair and broke his arm. Not in a place to be talking there, Kanter, but, you know, I'm also not an NBA athlete, so I can't really be saying, but, you know, and then afterwards, you know, they were saying Russ and KD ended up at the same restaurant after, just ignored each other. We talked a little bit about that earlier, Cam.
Yeah, Max, I want to bring up a hypothetical. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Russell Westbrook, KD meet each other at the same restaurant that same night, and apparently they don't even exchange a hello.
To ignore each other.
On a scale of 1 to 10, how petty is that?
Wait, so this didn't actually happen?
No, it did happen.
It did
happen.
Oh, it did happen.
If you were in this situation, what would you do? You have to say hello,
yeah,
right?
I mean,
I mean, I don't know. It's like right after the game, they just got beat down by them. They just got in, like,
you don't have to be buddy buddy, but hey, what's going on, man? For your 10-year teammate.
I don't know. In the last like 6-8 months, they haven't said a word to each other. It seems like. I can't. Why would you expect them to start right away?
Oddly similar to a high school breakup.
Yeah, no.
That's true.
Just not saying a word.
Like we were saying, you know, grown men acting not so much, not so much like that. But
goodness gracious, not even a hello, Troy.
I like, kind of. Don't fault Russ. Like I understand it, but it's still kind of petty. But it's funny. It's entertaining. I don't mind. Just knowing his personality, who he is, how he acts, like I wouldn't expect him to. But Max, there's one more grouping we've got. Another very interesting pair. Let us know who we got.
Well, we've got Charles Barkley, the Chuckster, along with LeBron James. So basically, Charles Barkley said in one of his TNT moments, he ranted. He said, "Inappropriate, whiny, all of the above. The Cleveland Cavaliers have given him everything he've wanted, and they've had the highest payroll in NBA history. He wanted J.R. Smith, and they got him. Kyle Korver, they got him. So really, everything here." He's the best player in the world. Does he want all the good players? He can't compete, or he doesn't want to compete. He's an amazing player. They're defending champs. So Barkley really just, you know, scrutinizing for LeBron James, just complaining.
Yeah, and then LeBron James fired right back. Obviously, he said, "I'm not going to let him disrespect my legacy like that." And James continued telling, he told ESPN, "I'm not the one who threw somebody through a window. I never spit on a kid, never had unpaid debt in Las Vegas. I never said I'm not a role model. I never showed up to All-Star Weekend on Sunday because I was in Vegas all weekend partying." And he added, "All I've done for my entire career is represent the NBA the right way. 14 years, never got in trouble. Respected the game. Print that. LeBron, that is what we did." So, Max, what do you make of this situation?
Having read the two quotes, is there someone you think is more right than the other? Is there someone that crossed a line, maybe?
Well, as much as I have respect for the best player in the game, LeBron James, I think he's at fault here. I mean, Charles Barkley is rightfully criticizing him for complaining, for having like everything he's want. He's got Cleveland, he's in his hometown, he's got the players that he wants to surround him. Maybe not the best, but
who
the organization. Yeah, it's the organization
payroll
he wants, you know?
Plus it's Charles Barkley's job to question it. He's an analyst.
Right.
That is
yeah.
literally what he's supposed to do. I think LeBron James went way over the line. Talking about personal stuff,
yeah.
stuff in the past from Barkley, I thought that was ridiculous. Barkley was criticizing on the court stuff, game stuff. Well, LeBron is blatantly attacking his character. I thought it was unacceptable. I thought he got way over his head here.
Yeah, I mean, LeBron's not wrong in what he's saying, but it's just not the right time, not the right situation for this. Like you said, there's no real reason to go after, you know, him personally, and there might not ever be a time for that, you know?
Yeah, I don't think Barkley, by any stretch, was making a personal attack on LeBron.
No.
Like LeBron came back at Barkley. I wasn't a fan.
I think they're talking more like the player, honestly, the GM LeBron, that he is, not so much who he is. I think it's pretty well known that LeBron is a very well-respected, authentic, you know, person. But as a player, obviously, he has some faults more in that regard. But
yeah, I don't know. I guess something just went up in his mind, and
yeah.
some ticked. And LeBron just stepped over the line. And
if you recall, this came during their little losing streak. They had they had a solid couple of weeks where they were really struggling
yeah.
there. And I think some frustration might have been creeping
Definitely.
In.
Probably.
They were dealing with some injuries, dealing with some losses, and maybe they struggled to get over that. Max, you made an excellent Cupid. Thank you for joining us today. Keep it locked as we wrap it up.
Growing up a Minnesota sports fan has always had its fair share of challenges. Just doesn't really help when Tom reminds me of them all the time.
Hey Carl, come in here, man.
Hey Tom, what's up?
Bro, check this out.
McDermott is the snapper.
Isn't that crazy, man?
Bro, where are you going?
Carl, come back.
Three, two, one, go ahead.
Tonight on E23.
All right, welcome back to Tailgaters. Cam, do you think Cupid tailgates?
Obviously, who doesn't love tailgating?
That is true. You know, you bring up a good point, Cam. Everybody does. But we'll get into some people that should probably be tailgating instead of playing in just a moment. But first, Cam, one of the big things today was Orlando Magic traded forward Serge Ibaka, the shot blocker, the rim rocker, all of that, to the Toronto Raptors for a first round pick and Terrence Ross. Any quick thoughts about that?
Yeah, I think it's a good move on each side. Orlando wasn't going to contend this year, and Ibaka's a free agent at the end of the season. They didn't think they could re-sign him, so you might as well get something back for him. And if you're Toronto, another key piece added to their what they want to be a championship run, and they're confident they can re-sign Ibaka. I like the move.
Yeah, and you know, added another rim protector, rebounder, and he's become more of a stretch four. He's extended his outside shot, so I like that. Another power forward to look at real quick, Kevin Love, out for 6 weeks. You know, Eastern Conference race for the top is kind of heating up. The Cavs still up top, Celtics close second, Wizards up third, so it'll be interesting to see how that, you know, impacts the going forward in the next couple weeks.
I don't think it will. He'll be back before playoff time. That's as true. Long as he's ready for the playoffs, same with J.R. Smith, they'll be just fine. They're the best team in the East, and it's not even close. But Troy, shifting away from basketball, it is Dingus time.
Not quite shifting basketball. Boneheaded. It was stupid. He's a dingus. I don't know what else to say about it. I wish I could get inside his head.
Dingus, I think, is the accurate word.
That's the only word you could use to describe it.
You could rate it dingus.
I would. Almost definitely would.
It's fair to say, certifiable dingus.
Yes. I would give him the certificate right now. That's what he is.
Certifiable dingus. Certifiable dingus. Dingus.
We're about to show now. These people are definitely going to need some love. I know Andrew Carlson does.
Yeah, he's a sad boy. No doubt. Go ahead and roll it.
I love you, though, Carl.
Michael Carter-Williams has a 4-on-1 fast break against the Minnesota T-Pups. Here's how they thought this would go. Some Showtime Laker action, baby.
But how'd it really go, Cam? Oh, let's take a look. That was almost cool.
Tragic Bronson alert, Michael Carter-Williams.
Sad.
You had four guys there and you threw it to no one. That's most
sad.
Unfortunate.
Oh boy. It was almost a cool play, but let's just take a look at that floor spacing, Cam. There wasn't any. They were all four of them within like a 2-foot radius in the lane.
Troy, somehow the Bulls thought this offseason they could have a whole team with Rajon Rondo being your best shooter. And
that's how you know it's bad. Yeah. I love my boy Rondo. Love him. Love the man like a brother. But when he's your best shooter, that's how you know you got a problem.
That's what you're going to get.
Unfortunately, with that is going to do it for this week. So be sure to head over to our website at mutv.missouri.edu. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and like us on Facebook. Stay updated with everything here at MUTV.
Yep, and make sure you catch all of our movies and shows on MUTV Stream and check out on social media Isaac Jahns, the guru. You saw him on tonight.
True.
He's the best. For my partner, Troy D'Souza, our analyst, Isaac Jahns, and Max Arnold, as well as everyone in the studio, I'm Cameron Redler.